You know, today as I was getting ready to prepare, I wanted to do something. Yesterday was a beautiful day here. Our church family is an amazing group of people. All of you out there, you're awesome. Believe in you. And man, about 3 or 4 months ago, we were so excited about bringing in all our brand new theater seating, the additional seating that was going to go behind the portable seating, and nearly 500 seats. Well, all that began to transpire, and of course, you're not here today, but yesterday, if you get a chance, if you have a Facebook account, you can go and see a beautiful church in Muncie, Indiana, brought their men down, and we were able to give that church 298 chairs. Those men were just overwhelmed, and we have a video of them coming in. We're so thankful, and just a hand clap from me to this church family for what you're doing. And if our cameraman can, they can pull out, and maybe you've noticed, we have one chair right here in the building, and we've taken some photographs of that, but it hit me that when it really comes down to it, when it's your worship, when it's your reading of the word, when it's your prayer time, it's an audience of one. It's you in that chair. It's you sending up your praise, sending up your worship, reading your word. And just as I got one chair right here and a solo audience, can I tell you that when you go into the presence of God, it's an audience of one, and don't be afraid. I also wanted you to see the auditorium because beginning tomorrow, the chairs are coming in. They'll begin the install. An exciting time. So keep giving, keep believing with us, and we'll see wonderful things. I want to talk to you today, and you notice I just brought a stool up, and I'm going to sit down and just have a family conversation. Now, as I begin to think about doing this in this manner, I wonder how the people are dressed. It's kind of a scary thought in some ways. You know, I can see maybe in their fuzzy pink bunny slippers, and some are in PJs. I have to be honest, I imagine my dad, he's probably sitting there in his suit and tie, as he would any time he would be in service. And then I began to think, what's it going to be like at Easter time when, you know, we're supposed to wear the fancy dresses and the hats? Maybe everybody can just like post them on Instagram and Facebook if we come to that. But I am sure many of you are sitting there in PJs and comfortable clothes and hair's messed up. And you know what? There's a certain niceness about that, that, you know, you don't have to get all dolled up. It's just you and God. So welcome this morning. Welcome to church. Hopefully you got a good cup of coffee in case I go long or get boring, but I wanted to spend a little time and talk to you. I want to tell you a story this morning, and I probably will get roasted for not like really preaching, but I took a little consensus with our group here, and rather than coming at you with a fiery message, thought it'd be great just to talk to you and actually have a story more than just anything that I want to talk to you. I have two thoughts this morning, and one is more practical, and the other is a spiritual principle that I think is important. I want to read just one verse of scripture. It's found in Psalms 118, the 24th verse. It says this, and you know this verse oh so well. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Now, I want to take just the first part of that real quickly before I get into my thought. And David did not define that day, did he? He simply said, this is a day that the Lord has made. We don't know when he wrote that what kind of day this was. It could have been a bad day. He could have had a fuss with his wife. He could have had a bad day in battle. He could have just got up and not, you know, you ever had one of those days that you woke up cantankerous? I've had a day or two that I got up on the wrong side of the bed, so I crawled back in for a half hour or so and got out on the other side. Didn't help much, but at least it was an attempt. But in this setting here, we don't know what kind of a day it was. Or it could have been an absolute fantastic day. Everything was successful. He had a great meal, had a good meeting with his warriors and with his captains and friends. We don't know. It simply says this is a day that the Lord has made. But then he defines it that regardless if it was a good day or if it's a bad day, if it's a good season or a bad season, if it's COVID-19 or we are absolutely running our tails off, the command is the same. We will rejoice and be glad in it. So I challenge you this morning that regardless of how you feel, anxiety, the uncertainty, the fear, the unknown that's out there, every day we get up, we have to make this choice. This is a day that the Lord has made. He's got something good in it. You may have to search it out a little bit more. You may have to work a little more at it. But I believe this, that if you have right approach, if you have right attitude, if you have right faith, if you have confidence in Jesus Christ, if you have confidence in the blood of Jesus is over you like it was at the time of the Passover, then everything somehow is going to be okay. I share that because I want to talk to you about how we approach each day. If you have never been to Noblesville, there's an ice cream shop on the old-timey square. It's called Alexander's Ice Cream Shop. 36 different flavors of ice cream. Sounding good right now. And part of our family tradition, we don't even know when it started. There was just a day, I don't know if we drove up that particular day or it was a day that we were on bicycles, but we went into Alexander's ice cream shop, and it's an old-fashioned looking building, kind of that soda shop feel, and they got food and stuff, but the main thing is the ice cream. As I said, 36 flavors. You have Super Friends and Peanut Butter Cup and Turtle Trail. I was kind of scared of that word, Turtle Trail. Rocky Road, Southern Pralines and Cream, and the list goes on and on. Thin Mint, you had your choice. And that was one of our family's favorite things to do. In fact, many of our great memories of our life are putting our bikes on the back of our car going up to a little city park called Potter's Woods, and we'd park our car there, take the bikes down, and we'd go across the bridge and then down through a path along White River, and it wound around for a couple, 2 or 3 miles, and then we'd head into Forest Park, and Forest Park was the old city park. There's a golf course and playgrounds and all kinds of stuff. There's a merry-go-round, and our kids, from the time they were young, they loved that. I think about it now and how torturous we may have been. Our kids were like 5 and 7. We had these nice 26-inch bicycles, and they were pedaling as hard as they could on these little 18-inch bicycles for miles. But they're strong now. They've survived. And we would stop there at the park, and they would swing and run and run, go down the slides and have a time. But all the time, our objective was one thing. It was to get to Alexander's ice cream shop. That was it. And when we got there, we would look, and we almost always knew what we were going to get. I don't know why, but we would go up and down and look at all the choices of flavors, and they had the little sample spoons, and we'd act like we're going to sample some different things. But generally, Rissa always went with Super Friends. I don't know, I think she's kind of a superhero. We love you, Rissa, if you're out there this morning. We love our little diva. Not really. And then Gentry loved cookie dough. Gentry would eat cookie dough without the ice cream, but, you know, his favorite was always the cookie dough ice cream. And Mary is, you know, who she is. She's Mary, and her ice cream choices would vary. It would be Turtle Tracks one day. It would be Pralines and Cream another day, and who knows? She is so inspired by the moment. It is incredible. But oftentimes, it was the Southern Pralines and Cream that she would have. And then me, in my diabetic state, made sure that I got plenty of chocolate and peanut butter, so that peanut butter cup, and we would sit there and eat our ice cream and enjoy the day. And as I thought about that moment, you know, something hit me. We never ordered vanilla. With all the choices, vanilla was there. And in fact, in the entire time, we've done this now probably for 10, 12 years, not one single time have we ordered vanilla. Now, you can do things with vanilla. You can put sprinkles on it, and that'll help. You can put syrup on it. You can put some fruit on it, some candy on it, some cookie thing. Something has to be done to vanilla because it's, well, it's just vanilla. And I thought about that. How many of us really want to live vanilla lives? Just a boring life. And here's the danger right now, is as we get closed in our lives, and as we work from home, and we have our kids not going to school, if we're not careful, our days can become very vanilla. We get up and we don't put a lot of energy into our day. We do our work. We waste our time in front of a computer screen, or we sit and look at social media for hours. And I want to encourage you, your life is better than vanilla. There's a multitude of things to do. And while we're quarantined in our house, we're not quarantined from creativity. We should be doing things. We should be stepping out. Get out there and Google and find a craft, find an activity. I put a list of things up here that we can do. First of all, just practically, to make sure that we're not ordering vanilla every day in our homes, in our lives. Your kids do not need vanilla ice cream right now. They need the Super Friends. They need the pralines and cream. They need the chocolate chunk and the cookie dough. They need some activity. So I kind of just put a list here together. You get on Google and find a game that you can create. Get a craft. Somebody put on one of the social media sites that I saw, they had a quarantine jar. And I thought that was interesting. That is the new take of the honeydew jar. And men, you might want to watch out. I have a feeling that they are close to realizing this is a prime opportunity to have that honeydew jar ready. But this quarantine jar, they had on the outside of that quarantine jar to do something physical, to do something spiritual, to do something that required exercise, that to do something that created, that you had to do something productive, creative, physical, spiritual, those four things. And I thought, what a creative idea, that you reach in that jar, and today we're not going to be vanilla, and you can do it as a couple. If you're a senior couple or a young married couple, just put some things in a jar and pull it out. It has to be in any one of those four categories, and this is what we're going to do today. You can pull out some old photos and begin to build maybe a year scrapbook on Shutterfly or something. You don't have to purchase it right now, but you can begin to design that. You can begin to do things that maybe you hadn't thought about doing to help others. You see, I think one of the things that will help you fulfill yourself and not have vanilla days is by writing, maybe going back and writing an old-fashioned letter and sending it, or getting a card and sending it to somebody. Text somebody. A phone call. Yeah, you actually push the numbers and you hear a ringing sound, and you could call somebody and have interaction, maybe FaceTime them. Things to get our lives out of mundane, because I'm afraid as we become more isolated and we have this social distancing, all these words that we're using, that if we're not careful, our days become vanilla. And may I suggest one other thing? Not only do we want to do that in our physical lives with our family, our spouses, paint a room, do a puzzle, whatever it is. Now some of our men are going to, I know you're not even going to send in your offerings when I said paint a room, because your spouse just looked at you like, yeah, great idea. The other side of this, though, is don't let your spiritual life go vanilla. You can say, well, it's just so mundane. I get up and I read my Bible and I pray and I do my little thing, but after a half hour, 15 minutes, it just seems, well, like I ordered vanilla ice cream. And I'm here to encourage you. Again, I put some things down for us. You know what? Be the church. This building, we're beginning to see. I think one thing that excites me more than anything is the church finally understands this. It's not this room. If we can pull back men for just a moment, it's not this room. It's not the corporate group. It's you in that church. You are the church. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And you are the greatest witness. So can I encourage you to be the church, to be the one that is putting out a positive post, that it's put something funny. Make someone laugh. Tomorrow, for all of those who are on Instagram, and if you don't have one, this might encourage you. For 26 years, I've lived with the most amazing 27 years. I'm in trouble. I cannot remember how many years. Oh, Lord, please help us. Can we pray right now? However long it's been, Mary has a wonderful knack of mixing her words up just enough to confuse somebody. And for a while, when we would laugh, she would get a little hurt by it, but now she has embraced her Maryisms. And so starting tomorrow, to help you laugh, I am going to be posting some of the most incredible funny Maryisms that I've experienced over the last 27 years. She is the most beautiful, wonderful woman, and God blessed me with an incredible wife. And just to break up the monotony, to make sure that we don't have a boring life, my gift and our gift, Mary is the one that's really making the sacrifice here, is she's going to allow me to begin to post Maryisms. And it may confuse you for a while, but in the end, you'll laugh. Those kind of things are important. Being the church, our world needs laughter. God laughed. God rejoiced. God celebrated. Your family needs laughter. It cannot be a concentration camp. It cannot be a prison. It can't be. You've got to create an atmosphere. And the best way to create the best atmosphere is to include God in that part of your life. I would encourage you to do this, to get into the Word of God in creative ways. Go and pull up YouTube. I've got 5, 6, 7 different men that I watch. I love their messages. I'm inspired by them. They're not all of the same faith, but if they're preaching Jesus, I'm going to tell you, it's good to listen to encourage yourself in the Lord. And I encourage you to do that. I encourage you to not only just do those kind of things, but also to get a praise on, to get some music on. We used to have Dance Dance Revolution with our kids. Now we got it simplified where we could just put on some good stuff, and we don't only have to have the whole audience. We could just do the funky chicken right in our home and have good. You get exercise, you do some worship, and you know what? When you get done doing that, you feel better. You have to sometimes, what the Bible says, encourage yourself in the Lord. How about taking an online Bible study? There's Bible studies. Beth Moore has stuff. Our ladies, you've been doing the Priscilla Shire. Hop on and find a good Bible study and inspire yourself. Don't do vanilla church. We're not a vanilla church. We have never been a vanilla church. We believe in worship and praise here in the building. We raise our hands. We come to the front. Can I tell you, it doesn't have to be locked inside this building. It should be locked inside your heart, and it's not quarantined by it not being, you can't be in here in the building. Make your home a place of praise. Go outside and do a prayer walk. Maybe one day all you do is go pray blessings on every person you know. God said, bless your enemies. So one day, no asking for anything. I bless this family, and I bless that family, and bless your bosses, and bless your company. Another day, pray favor over people. Another day, just do something and give thanks, walking along. Create areas in your yard that when you go and stand here, this is my area where I give thanks. You see what I'm saying? I'm afraid too many of us has relegated ourselves down to vanilla Christianity. Well, I have to sit here with a cup of coffee and be solemn. No. God is a God of excitement. That's why I don't think any one miracle is ever repeated. He did one Jericho walls falling. He did one lion's den. He did one 3 men in a fire, in a fiery furnace. And I'm here to tell you, if you'll get out and enjoy life, you'll do something that will create such energy. And can I tell you, we have the possibilities right now to create some of the most incredible memories. Don't look at this as a negative. Don't look at this as something that your government is doing. Look at this as a gift from the Almighty Creator, that you can spend time with your family, with your kids, with your spouse, and you can do all kinds of things. There is no governor. There is no limit on the creativity. Just decide to order anything but vanilla in your day. My final thoughts as I come to an end today is this, and a little more solemn. I want to read two portions of Scripture because I think that if we fail as pastors and ministers to bring up the reality that that there is a possibility, and I've not heard this said much, but that we could be coming near the end of time, that God could come again. It's not something we hear much anymore, that God could come again. It's like we all say, well, no man knows the day or no hour. Yeah, that is true. Nobody knows that exact moment. But can I suggest to you that when times begin to get critical, we become aware? You know, we heard of COVID-19, and we didn't think about it so much, but then it became a reality, and now it's setting right in our lap, in the very rooms of our homes. Now we're aware. And can I tell you what God didn't say you would know the day nor the hour. I believe we can know when there's a season. Let me read to you what 2 Timothy 3:1 says. But realize this, that in the last days, difficult or perilous times, another version say, will come. May I suggest, yes, I believe that we're living in perilous, in difficult times. Can I get a raising of hands out there in our streaming audience? Hey, you didn't raise your hand. Nudge them, sitting there on their couch, eating their cereal right now. Hands up. There's not a person, hardly. I say that because in reality, there's not a person in this audience today that doesn't realize these are difficult times. Our government doesn't know what to do. As a husband, as a minister, you know, people look and think, we don't have the answers. But I have the source. I have the God Creator that does have the answer. And he did say that perilous times would come. And when you look in reality, why we don't know the day or the hour, when things begin to transform, I just want to suggest the possibility. I may be totally wrong, but I'm willing to take that chance. I'm willing to work on my reputation right now. That God could come. And we need to hear this message right now. There are droughts and devastating fires that took place in Australia. There are hordes of locusts that are attacking the continent of Africa right now. We're having earthquakes in different places. Utah, Salt Lake City, Utah, just had an earthquake. It's been a long time since it's there. Croatia this morning had an earthquake. We're fighting this pestilence, this COVID-19 that we've never faced. Could I suggest that just as the Bible said, difficult times will come? And then let me read also Matthew chapter 24, verses 36 and 37, and then skipping down to verse 42. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. Why he's saying you cannot know the moment, he is saying know the season. Know that it was like it was in the time of Noah. What happened in the time of Noah? Very few people believed in heaven and hell. Very few people believed in God. Very few people had any reverence or fear. They did their own thing. They had no ruler. They had no morals. They had no values. There was drunkenness. There was immorality. All the things that we are facing as a society, not just here in the United States, but worldwide. That is what was happening in the time of Noah. And God was willing to tell us through Matthew that as it was in the time of Noah, the season, so shall it be when he comes again. And so I spend a serious moment with you. Are you ready? Can I ask it again? Are you ready? You may not believe, but I'm still going to ask you the question. Just in case this Bible is true. I believe it's true with all my heart. But if you're there as a doubter or a cynic, is it worth the chance? If there was a small possibility, wouldn't it be advantageous to your life to say, just in case, I want to be ready? And what if, just as it was in Noah's day, God says, I'm giving you a sign. This time of COVID-19 and all these things, those were a sign for you. I encourage you this morning on a serious note as I begin to come to a close. We must be ready. Matthew chapter 24, verse 42 says this, therefore, be on alert. To our church family, be on alert. Don't be vanilla. To every young person, be on alert. For you do not know which day your Lord is coming. Fact. I wouldn't be worth the salt of a pastor this morning as I watch all the signs and all the things that are unfolding. I'm not an end-time preacher. I don't understand all of Revelation. I don't know that anybody actually could fully grasp it. God brings John into the heavens. And there he sees things, and then he's got to come back down and write it into a form that humanity can understand. And I know God can give revelation. My point is simply, I'm not here to say that I've studied it all perfect, but I do believe this. That God is coming again. And whether it's today, next week, next month, next year, or 100 years, wouldn't it be wise to be ready? I shared the story before our church is shut down about being a young man. I don't even know exactly where it is in Scripture, even at this second. Where it said the water would be turned into blood. But I remember the day that Mom wasn't at home. Mom was always at home. Dad would be at work, but I'd come in from school and expect to see Mom, and she wasn't there, and she wasn't going to be there. Normally, Dad would be there or somebody would be there. But this particular day, nobody was there. And I lived far from God. I fought this truth. I fought the message, the gospel. I fought turning myself over to Jesus Christ. I fought repentance and confession. There's pride there. Maybe some of you are fighting that today. I had that. I was baptized, but I still hadn't surrendered. And there may even be people that have repented, been baptized, even been filled with the Spirit, but you're living hard. You're living away from God. And I share this story with you. It's kind of a funny story. I came in that day and couldn't find them. You know, of course, we didn't have cell phones. And I called, and I couldn't get anybody anywhere. And so the next thing that I knew was I remembered that verse that Pastor N.A. Urson preached and Pastor Larson preached. I thought, oh, no, the Lord has come, and I have missed it. I have played around. And I'll never forget running into the kitchen and grabbing the faucets and turning on the water and expecting to see blood. I was so relieved when it was water. God didn't come. But can I tell you, he could come. And so as we come to a close this today, my closing thoughts are this. Are you ready? I want to pray over you and I want you to pray there if it's safe. I know we're practicing social distancing. Maybe if you're sitting apart from one another, just put a hand towards that person that is saying, maybe you can say to somebody that's right there in the room with you, I need God. I need him in my life. It's time for me to come home. It's time for me to surrender my heart to him. And we're going to pray. And repentance is simply a change of direction, a change of course. You're walking one way, and all you're going to do is say, starting today, I'm changing from the vanilla life of this world to an exciting life with Jesus Christ. I want him to be a part of my life, my heart again. If he's never been a part of that, he's ready to take residence. Well, what I need to do? Three things have to work. One, you simply say, God, I confess I need you. I repent. We're going to pray. You pray your prayer and I'll pray over you. And then the second thing, I'm going to encourage you to get baptized. Here at our church, we'll schedule a time to meet with you. 317-213-8400. I don't know if we have the ability, men, to get that verse up there or that phone number up there, but if we can, 317-213-8400. We will have somebody here, and we don't care if we're doing it every hour. Be baptized. And if you're not near us, go and find a church and say that I want to be baptized in water. I want to be baptized in the name of Jesus. I want to get my sins remitted. And when you come up out of that water, you have been adopted by Jesus Christ. Your life has changed. His covering is over your life. I believe the blood has been applied. And then I want you to know, thirdly, you have a promise that if you seek him, the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God. I'm not here saying seek the gift of the Holy Spirit. I'm here to say seek God. Seek to know him. Have a hunger for him. And when you seek that, he promises you he will fill you with an evidence of his Spirit, and your life will forever be changed. Bow your heads now. Lord, we come this morning. All of us need the foot of the cross. All of us need the blood. And on our live stream this morning, there are so many myriads of people. There are those who are just beginning their walk with God. This may be their first time to watch a message or just the first few times. I'm asking that you would help them. Maybe they're alone or with others. And even if they're with others, that they can spend some time praying after this service saying, God, I just confess I need you. I believe you came. I believe you died. I believe you resurrected. And I believe you took care of my sins. When we confess that and we ask for forgiveness, that you, God, have taken away our sins and we're going to start relying upon that. God, that is the completion of repentance. I pray a spirit of brokenness and humility would step into those rooms throughout this country and around the world where people may be watching right now. Let your spirit fall into each and every home. Let it be deposited in our hearts and let there be a brokenness because we do not know the day or the hour that you're coming. And then give us the courage not just to repent, but to pick up our phones and find a place to go and be baptized if we've never done that. And then we'll have this confidence. And God, we know the promise of your spirit is there. We ask all these things. We ask your favor and your blessings and your protection over everybody that's watching and those that will watch this on our rebroadcast on YouTube. I pray that in the days and weeks to come, as this sermon is just watched, that the anointing and the presence of God will grab them in this very moment, just as it is as we're here live. And that's throughout the weeks and months to come, as we share this message with others, it will bring people to the foot of the cross. It will bring them to the waters of baptism, and great revival can happen in the midst of our crisis. We thank you, Lord, for being the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the provider of all that we need. Help us to be faithful in our giving, in our tithings and our offerings. By doing so, we're showing our confidence in you, and not in our government, and not in our finances. I pray that our church will be bold and faithful in all that we're called to do, to touch lives this week, to be a blessing, to be what you want us to be, Jesus, the church in a world, to be salt and light. Help us to receive this challenge in Jesus' name. Now, just a reminder, if you're watching on any of our venues, it will probably fall off of our, of course, our website. It will leave our Facebook. Maybe we'll try to get that back up. But within an hour to two, this entire service, music and everything, will be on YouTube. You can watch it. You can share it from there. Please do that, church. Make that your goal, to touch somebody with this message. I felt like it was an important message this morning, that they need Jesus Christ. God bless you. Have a great week. Remember, when you get down to pray this week, no ordering vanilla ice cream. Go for the turtle tracks. Go for the rocky road. Get the elephant ear. Get the vanilla mint. Do something, but no vanilla. God bless you.